So in my video about adventure games, I was talking about how games that just roll out linear plots that stop every now and again for some insipid gameplay challenge or other aren't realizing the full potential of interactive narrative. But it was unfair to pick on adventure games alone for that. Most video games use that narrative model. It's basically what I'm talking about when I talk about Ghost Train Rides, a linear path broken up with token copy-pasted fights. The Ubisoft model of open-world game frequently tells its main story with a strictly linear sequence of cutscenes and missions, the only actual freedom on offer being deciding how much to faff about between each one. I'm of the opinion that video games are our gateway to new and fascinating ways of telling stories that we're only just beginning to explore, having been stuck for many years with open quotes cinematic narrative-based games like The Last of Us that aim to mimic films, the way films initially tried to mimic stage plays, before they evolved and discovered the unique strengths of their own medium. But I know what you wonder, viewer. You wonder, what the fuck are you on about, Yahtzee, when you talk about interactive narrative and non-linear narrative? What possible other ways are there of telling stories? Surely a story is an inherently linear thing. A beginning, a middle, and an end. It's over as soon as the princess is rescued, gets married, is horribly killed, or gets a face full of cum, depending on the genre. See, that attitude just shows how mired everyone's thinking is after generations of linear storytelling. More and more lately, video games have been showing us that the positive feelings of discovery and emotional catharsis we've always gotten from good stories can be had without having to be shackled to notions like beginning, middle, end, and one thing happening after another. I should stress at this point that when I talk about non-linear narrative, I most certainly do not mean branching paths. In your Telltale David Cage Dark Pictures anthology sort of vein. Because that's still linear narrative. It's just linear narrative with more than one line. And the end result is almost always a letdown, because the fact that the story has to occupy a quantum superstate of every possible version of events being simultaneously true creates a certain blandness. No, the kind of storytelling I'm talking about is less like conveyor belts of events trundling by in front of us, and more about immersing us in a big soapy bath of ideas and settings and feelings and letting us find our own route to the plug hole. In fact, why don't we just call it that? Immersion storytelling. There's a reason why Dark Souls has practically defined the current era of innovation in game narrative, and Elden Ring has continued its legacy. You're not so much living a heroic story in these games as showing up after all the heroic stories are over, when the dust has settled and the world is putting the chairs on the tables in preparation for closing time. Oh sure, there are linear stories in Elden Ring, the side plots attached to specific characters, and the little stories the player makes for themselves, in the same way that a single frame of a film can be recreated as a painting. But it's just one thread in a ball of wool, one needle in a haystack. You're not there to be spoon-fed a plot, you're there to simply exist in that setting. Turn over all the stones and piece together your own impression of how things got to where they are. There's no real beginning or end. Virtually everything that's really interested me from a storytelling perspective lately has embraced immersion narrative of one kind or another. Most recently, 13 Sentinels, Aegis Rim caught my interest by the way it tells all the different bits of its story in whatever order the player chooses. It's a completely balmy story, but the format of surrounding the player in its many threads and letting them spread everything out like the guts of a dead squirrel on tarmac probably lets it get away with being very balmy and complicated in the way that a film or a TV series wouldn't. Tunic is a recent game that does a lot of the Dark Souls thing, and simultaneously evokes a weirdly nostalgic feeling of trying to make sense of something from a foreign culture. For immersion narrative is about evoking abstract feelings as much as it's about recounting strict sequences of events. Disco Elysium evokes the abstract feeling of being hungover after destroying your own identity with alcohol. Yeah, we've all been there. Return of the Obra Dinn is an absolutely brilliant work of immersion narrative. I love the way it juxtaposes the protagonist's mundane bureaucratic task against the epic tale of maritime horror that disjointedly comes together in the background. The very mechanics of the gameplay go towards that effect as we ghost around the final moment of some poor bastard's life, copying down what's written on everyone's name tags. It's like skating across a frozen lake full of bodies and bizarre creatures that you can only observe because you're stuck on your side of the ice. As I said, video games have only recently started to really explore the potential of immersion narrative. Souls-likes, roguelikes, and the recent trend for time loop games have all realized that once you unshackle yourself from conventional storytelling methods, even player death can be just another method for discovery. But immersion narrative has been toyed with for a long time. Old 90s CD-ROM adventure games like Myst, The Seventh Guest, and Zork Nemesis were somewhat on the way to what Return of the Obra Dinn does, a bunch of innocuous gameplay tasks to keep you occupied as you tread water over a disconnected mass of story you're not really participating in. But you know what genre I think has always been a spearhead for unconventional storytelling? Fighting games. I'm not talking about those story campaigns that Netherrealm fighters like Injustice and Mortal Kombat X have had, hilarious though they are, with their sub-Saturday morning cartoon great writing. Right from Street Fighter 2 onwards, fighting games have always been about giving us a range of colourful, larger-than-life characters, any one of whom would adequately function as a protagonist, and all we can know about them is what can be conveyed through the way they look, the way they move, and their brief snippets of dialogue. And their story endings, of course, and it's only by piecing together all those story endings that we get the full intended experience of the game's setting. I find it all very fascinating. Even while I can't stand playing fighting games, because if I wanted to learn how to crack off complex button combinations with 2 frames worth of reaction time, I'd eat 3 pot brownies and try to play Guitar Hero. Immersion narrative is something utterly unique to interactive media. The complex subtleties of Tunic and Obra Dinn would be completely impossible in a movie, TV show, or book. That's why it irks me whenever the media talks about how a video game is getting a Netflix adaptation, in such a way as to imply that this is some elevation of the material. It's not. It's a reduction, and you should never expect much. Any more than you'd expect from, say, a big-budget action movie being adapted for the stage, or to a series of static paintings in a room. You ever read Slaughterhouse-5, there's an alien race in that book called the Tralfamadorians who experience all of time simultaneously, and they regard the way in which humans experience time to be akin to having severe disabilities. There's this whole passage where they compare it to being tied to a conveyor belt while only being able to look out through a hole in a bucket on your head, or something like that. And it's that passage that I think about when I consider the prospect of adapting something like Elden Ring to film. It's like trying to appreciate a Renaissance painting through a microscope. It's like trying to make out with your sweetie while both your hands are trapped in Pringles tubes and your head stuck in a bread bin. Ultimately, you don't get anything out of it, besides bread.